he comes by and watches.
Oh, wow. Okay. You're doing all sorts of stuff.
I am. Yep. You got to, and it, I have it all ready to like click, 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 click. And then once we go live, then I don't have to worry about it again.
Okay.
Perfect. All right. Looks like we are golden. Let me just click to make sure that the link I sent out is right, because that's always important to make sure the thing you told everybody to go look at is the correct thing to go look at. Perfect. Awesome. All right, folks. Welcome to Getting Felt Up, a puppetry podcast with Dan and Nate. Nate is going to be here soon. His microphone, he's currently fighting. He's fist fighting with his microphone in his little in his little studio. So so he's restarted his computer. He's now rebooting his mic, and then he'll be with us very shortly. So you only have to listen to me talk half the time. You only have to listen to me talk the full time for just a few more minutes. But very excited about our guest today, because as everyone who watches this podcast or listens to this podcast knows, I am a tremendous Eureka's Castle fan. It was my number one show as a child. Eureka's Castle and Barney, they would always go head to head during my childhood. And of course, I was known for running around my house with a towel around my neck, just intentionally slamming into everything I could, like Batley, and then, you know, standing up and saying, I meant to do that. So I am super, super excited to have the one and only Mr. Brian Meal here to chat with us a little bit about his history of puppetry. And of course, we'll talk a little bit about Eureka's Castle, just a little bit, maybe a lot. So welcome to the show, sir. It's a pleasure to have you.
Oh, well, thank you very much for having me on. I'm looking forward to it.
So it's probably been a while since you've wiggled the dolls, right? Because now you're like this acclaimed author of children's stories, and you're writing all these wonderful novels. Are they novels or books? I don't know what the definition is.
The first one I wrote was a middle school novel, and then everything I've done since have been YA novels. But yeah, about I would say in the '90s, mid '90s, I put down the puppets and picked up the pen. And Dan, it's interesting you mentioned Eureka's Castle, because that was my pivot point. When Jim Krupa wanted me to come and do some of the characters for Eureka's Castle with Hugh Martin, the director, and everything, and they were putting that show together with Kit Laybourne, and I basically said I'm perfectly happy to come back and do puppets, but on a condition: I want to write for the show.
Nice.
So I ended up both puppeteering and writing for the show, because at that point I got married in 87. I had young kids and I was tired of the hurry up and wait life in the studio. And, I wanted to pivot to writing. So I had the 20-second commute in my socks to my writing desk. and granted, I spent a lot of shooting time down in Florida, but Eureka's Castle provided a wonderful opportunity for me to kind of make that shift from puppeteering to writing.
That's awesome. That's tremendous.
I'm sorry I'm late, and I came in ready to Eureka's Castle.
Nate's here.
Woo-hoo. My apologies. And we're live. Oh, goodness gracious. I had this technical difficulties. Luckily, I have more than one mic, so I switched out mics.
Wait till you're as old as me, Nate, and there are a lot more technical difficulties.
Some technical, some not technical.
So it's nice hearing, because in researching, it's funny because I'm looking at all the roles that you've played, and you know, like on Sesame and whatnot, and it shows like, you know, 1984 is like the cutoff on like a bunch of characters, and you know, like, and then in the late 80s, because I was born in 87, so like your puppetry career like lined up with like my birth, like the end and the beginning. So
Brian, you might be responsible for the birth.
Exactly. I left Sesame Street in 86, which was I left in the 16th season, and maybe that allowed for your existence. You know, I got out of the way. I got out of the way of Kevin Clash to make Elmo famous.
Yeah, you know? I heard.
That's what I'm most famous for as a puppeteer, is getting out of people's way.
Brian, you're dropping all these great little tidbits. All these great little teasers of all these wonderful stories. No, I love the idea of like you giving up the puppetry ghost in 86 and then it entering my body in 87.
There you go. And you know what, Dan? You can have it, man.
Well, Brian, if you're familiar with The Muppet Christmas Carol, Dan, if you look at him, he looks very much like the Ghost of Christmas Present.
Ah, yes. I might have to go back and look, but yeah, this is getting freaky. I'm beginning to think that Nate and I should be interviewing Dan.
Yeah.
Let's turn the table on him.
So Brian, let's go all the way back. Let's start with your puppet beginnings, because
or as we like to call it, the puppet Sega Genesis.
Yeah, your puppetry Genesis. So because a lot of puppeteers, they either start very young and they're just super into it, either through church puppets or just loving the TV show, or just seeing puppets on TV. So where did the puppet bug bite you? Where did it all start?
Well, I'll try to make it short, but I was a very much a physical performer. I actually came out, I was a jock in high school. I was too small to play sports. I wanted to be a ballet dancer. So I ended up with a theater company in Maine that was basically this crazy mime. It should have been called the Noisy Mime Theater. And I was there for 5-6 years. In my early 20s, and I, felt like there were pine trees growing out of my ears in Maine. So I moved back to New York to get back to my acting career, and I ended up in a show called Moominshots. And Moominshots was this Swiss company.
Really?
Yeah, I was in Moominshots.
Man, I love you more and more. We've only been talking for 5 minutes. All right, this is fantastic.
We got a romance going. So I was in the first replacement cast on Broadway for Moominshots. No, I'm sorry, the second replacement cast. So I was there from 79 to 80 doing this very large a body puppetry mime kind of stuff. And Sesame Street was looking for a body puppeteer to take over Barkley, the dog. Before you go into
that, can you just talk to me? Because I always pronounce it Moominshots, but what's the right way to say it?
It's Moominshots.
Moominshots. And so what was your favorite, looking back, what was your favorite bit, absurd bit that you did with that, when you were doing it?
I think I think it was either called Transformation. They were all sketches, these visual sketches. But the most incredible thing about performing Moominshots, and I did it on Broadway for a year, was it was like doing an hour and 40 minutes of silent stand-up comedy, because you were constantly playing. You couldn't often see the audience. I was in the blob in the very first number. I couldn't even see. I could hear them. But you were constantly working off the rhythms of the laughter in the audience. And wow. It was a wonderful kind of a theatrical experience, because the only sounds we made were like maybe foot stomps or something like that. And so that was a great show to do. For Barkley the dog on 7th Street, here came over. They auditioned me, and I got the part of Barkley. So I started out a body puppeteer with Muppets. And are we still good?
Yeah, we're good. You had a little bit of a hiccup there, but you're all right.
Okay. So one of the ironies was I came in as a body puppeteer. When I first met Jim Henson, I was in a prototype of a Mystic costume for Dark Crystal in the Muppet Shop. And I was locked in this costume, and I hear this voice, hey, who's that? And I'm going, my God, that's Henson. And I got out of the costume, and it's the first time I met him. And basically, after, Henson saw some of my work at a festival and my work in Barkley, he said, do you want to learn how to do hand puppets? And this is, I don't think I've ever confessed this on such a public thing, but I always hated puppets, but I wanted to do the voices. And I said to Henson, not knowing the guy, he said, yeah, I'd love to learn to do hand puppets if I can do the voices. I was kind of pushy. I was a 25. Stupid kid. And he said, yeah, sure, fine. So I ended up spending a summer kind of learning hand puppetry. The rest was going into the hand puppets, Telly and all the other characters. And I loved doing the voices. And I was very bad. I was the bad boy on Sesame Street. I would finish with my puppet and I'd just throw it on the floor. And the puppet handlers just hated me. Ooh, yeah. I was abusive and non-respectful to the puppets.
So tell me about the audition process they put you through for Barkley. Was it like an open call, or did they find you and see that you were a good...
They knew about the Moomin Chance cast, and they called me up, and I went in, and I auditioned for Lisa Simon, and I think Dulcie Singer was there too. And they only put me in the stilts in the front of the costume, and then the head. I didn't have the full body thing on. And I think what might have nailed it for me was, you know, I was just doing some dog behavior in the costume, because a dog, you had to act like a natural dog. And one of the feathers fell off the head in the audition. And me doing Barkley freaked out about this feather and started like attacking and barking it and all that stuff. So it was a little bit of it wasn't exactly the gum under the stool with Barbara Streisand, but it was a little bit of improv. And one of the fun things is the original conception of Barkley, there was a guy named Toby, someone who did him 6 months before me, was the dog was smart. And when I went into my first production meeting after getting the part, I said, listen, it looks like a totally natural dog. It's got to be the stupidest, most enthusiastic dog in the world. You know, let's not make it an intelligent dog. Let's make it a this wonderful, loving, dopey dog that can't learn a trick, et cetera. And that's how Barkley kind of took off from there. I mean, the great thing about Muppets was the puppeteers and the writers and the people who conceived the characters, it was a collaboration. And often, whatever the writers conceived of, and Telemonster is a perfect example, whatever the writers conceived of ended up being completely different by the time the character was realized in front of the camera.
Huh. Yeah, that's amazing. I love that story that you wandered into. So you're saying, though, that the first time you met Jim, you were in a Mystic costume. So was he just not around or present on the set of Sesame during the process that you were...
Yeah, because they were still doing the Muppet Show in London. So Jim, when I first started out, Jim was in London, and then he was doing pre-production with some prototype costumes and stuff on Dark Crystal. He's doing very initial work. Now you got to realize this was 80. Dark Crystal wasn't shot until I believe 81 and then released in 82. So there was a ton of pre-production. So that's why I met him when I was in one of his costumes, and he was kind of recruiting body puppeteers. And the most fantastic thing for me was because the main Muppet guys were in London shooting, and they were very unavailable for Sesame Street because they were shooting the Muppet Show. I was like the new kid on the block, and I got to play just about everything because there was a lack of puppeteers on Sesame Street at the time, because of the veterans being in London.
Oh, that's incredible. Yeah, I never really put two and two together that the opportunities probably opened up for a lot of people, in New York working on the show, because there were so many, when Jim was alive, he had so many projects and things going on at the same time that there were only so many puppeteers. And so I never really thought that would have opened up the potential for other people to advance and grow and succeed.
Yeah,
it happens.
Yeah, it was so open, Dan, that I played a lot of female characters, and by the time I left Sesame Street 5-6 years later, the rule that they wanted to bring in more women puppeteers, and the rule became gender specific. Only women played women characters, and only guys played guy characters. But I got to play Grungetta, Oscar's girlfriend,
which is pretty great. Now performed by Pam, good friend of the podcast. So
the other character was, because Jerry Nelson wasn't around, I did several pieces of the Contessa, which was a female equivalent of the Count. And that character, I don't know why it got killed, but I remember some fun segments with her.
Yeah, they had kept the pattern rolling of just taking a character and then making a lady version of it. Lord only knows what kind of Muppets we would have ended up with on Sesame Street. You know, big Berta.
That's what I'm thinking. That's the first one you think of.
Yeah,
is
right.
Female version of Bert.
Berta. Ernessa.
Yeah. That's fantastic. That is so funny. Yeah. All right. So you played around on Sesame Street for a while, and that's pretty great. And then you're in one of the most iconic Henson movies. I mean, I think all of his movies are pretty iconic, but The Dark Crystal is just something that's just wonderful and fantastic. And
that movie still visually holds up.
So beautifully, so wonderfully, and that experience just must have been incredible. So you were in doing some body work in a Mystic, but you ended up playing one of the Skeksis, right?
Yes, I played the ornamentalist, and that was just a great opportunity because I got to go over and work on the last six Muppet shows when I was kind of an underling and training as a puppeteer, and we were beginning to do pre-production on Dark Crystal. And we basically did, because of the Muppet Caper, I believe. What's the second Muppet movie? The Muppet Caper, right?
The Great Muppet.
That was being shot while we were doing almost a year of pre-production to get the body puppeteers in shape. I was one of the main trainers for the body puppeteers. And Dark Crystal was a fantastic experience. In fact, you told me to bring some visuals. Here's my original script of The Dark Crystal.
Oh, get out of here.
And it's got all, it's actually, because I play the Dying Master, it's got all my acting notes and everything from that. It was the first 3 days of shooting. We shot the Dying Master scene. And I still have the original script. And this guy was a little broken. And here is my prototype toy.
Oh, wow.
Can you see it?
There you go. A little higher.
Yeah.
Perfect.
That's the prototype toy that I ended up with of a Mystic, you know?
That's really cool. That's incredible.
So the Dark Crystal was truly a once-in-a-lifetime experience, and it was great. I think it took up 14 months of my life.
I'm trying to think of, because they had at the Center for Puppetry Arts in Georgia, they had a Skeksis. It's now put away. I think it's like in storage. I'm trying to remember. I don't know which one it was, because there was like 10 or 12 of them, right?
There was 12. There was, I believe, 12. 12 Mystics, 12 Skeksis.
Yeah. So that's pretty great, though. I know that you played a Skeksis. I didn't know you played the Dying Master in the beginning, too. That's phenomenal. But there were like six puppeteers on each of those Mystics, right? Like, I mean, they were just massive.
The Mystic stuff, there's a lot of cable stuff. And my little Dying Master story for you was that it was the first day of shooting. And Dave Bowles was originally supposed to play the Dying Master. And he got into the costume and he said, "No way." He said, "This is too painful." And, you know, I'm a 25-year-old idiot. It's like, nah, what's the problem? After Barkley, it's nothing.
Yeah. Right, cool. I got this.
That's incredible. So when I was just watching clips of like the Skeksis dinner just before we started to pick out you. And there's one or two great little clips. What was it like being inside of those, at this point, just legendary puppets? I mean, it's incredible that, it's incredible to be sitting here talking to you because you were one of the 12. What was it like puppeteering those massive, because I've seen one in real life. I've seen one in person and those things are like,
are you
monsters.
Talking about the Skeksis or the
Garfins? The Skeksis.
Yeah. They were actually not that difficult because you were basically, it was a rig that you crawled into and you were puppeteering, you know, the head. And then you had all sorts of cable people doing eyes, eyelids, brows. You know, it was basically an ensemble of puppeteers working those things. But physically, they weren't, you know, to me, if you were vertical and standing up, it wasn't that bad.
Yeah.
You know,
did you have a right hander or was it someone doing the hands and you were just concentrating on the head?
Oh boy, that's a good question, Dan. I was probably, I was probably doing the left hand. It was probably traditional right, left hand. And someone might've been doing the right hand. But I don't remember puppeteering the ornamentalist. I don't remember going anywhere except for maybe one running away shot. But we basically, the Skeksis basically stayed at that banquet table, except for the other prime ones like Dave Goals. You know, the two or three lead Skeksis may have moved around more. But the ones that stood at the banquet table were fairly stationary.
Yeah, it just tickles me so much. And then did you play any other ancillary characters in the movie?
Well, the Dying Master was probably the other big one. I also played Urza, who is the head mystic. You know, the Dying Master dies at the beginning of the film and gives Jen and his quest. And that was a whole different experience because I ended up recording the audio for that in three different countries, because they kept rewriting that. In any case, I played a bunch of, I played some Garthams, did the big heavy Garthams, and those were like 75 pound. Those were intense costumes.
Yeah. I was just at the Center for Puppetry Arts last month and they have one, of the whole complete costumes. They have a Gartham there on display. And I was like up close. It creaked me out. It was freaky looking. Cause then I'm like up close looking. I'm like, this must've been a beast to wear. Cause it just looks so heavy and hot. It must've been quite an experience wearing those things.
Well, I just did an interview, an audio interview with a guy who's writing, the book of the new book about the making of the Dark Crystal.
Right.
I've forgotten his name. It's coming out in the fall along with the comic book. But he told me a story that I'd never heard about. But after the movie was released, they took a Gartham, a Skeksis, and a Mystic to a television studio in London and had them in front of a kid audience. And they did all the stuff with the Gartham, and the kids freaked out. They were petrified. And I've been told, the guy that interviewed was supposed to send me the link, but I've been told you could find this on YouTube.
That's amazing.
Oh, I'm looking for it.
Was it for like an ad for the movie, or did they just bring
it was an interview on some kind of talk show.
Wow.
And I'm literally making a note right now to look at this because we do this bit on our show where we do like little mini episodes called Petrifying Puppets, where we talk about puppets that are supposed to be, you know, interesting, artistic, stylized, but, or just regular characters. But then when you as a youth watched it, just terrified you and permanently scarred you. You know what I mean? Like just for good. For me, it was intentionally scary, but that Chucky puppet doll does me in. But like, you know, we've got friends who like E.T., particularly like when he's like all pale and dead in the river, or just the fact that he has like human teeth. I don't know if you ever noticed that or not, but E.T. has like people teeth, not like alien teeth. And so for one of our buddies who's been on the show, just unsettled him deeply as a child.
Here's the adult that's still traumatized by puppets that I'd like to meet. The adult former kid who is petrified of Barney.
Oh, really?
There must be someone out there. How sensitive would that person be?
Well, you know what? Original OG Barney, because I was, like I said at the beginning of the show, Barney and Eureka's Castle were my thing growing up.
Okay.
And then eventually, like, it's kind of embarrassing to say considering who I am today, but like Sesame Street, it was like ancillary to me. It was like, I watched it. It was there, but like Eureka's Castle was my jam and Barney was my jam. And Barney, old school Barney, first season Barney, absolutely terrifying. He's like dark purple.
Walking bruise.
The eye, like the eyebrows on him were like slightly just like a little too menacing. It just was like a very rigid and like just like very terrifying. But then they rebuilt him and he was all rounded edges. You know, he was like very square and boxy.
Yeah. So there's a special group out there with Barney trauma. I love it.
Yeah, there's a special group out there who are scared of Barney, but that's wonderful. And so I imagine you going to the premiere, but you were saying that when you were out there working on it, you then got to hang around the Muppet Show and work on a couple episodes because you were out there.
Yeah, I was in kind of my, training apprentice phase. I was in the last, I was, you know, ancillary puppeteer in the last six episodes while we were getting ready. But, you know, I once I was done with Dark Crystal, I had to get back to Sesame Street. So I basically spent 5 years going from London to New York, New York to London. And I think in those 5 years, I may have had 2 weeks off because, you know, between the Muppet Show, the movies, and Sesame Street, you were busy all year round. And, you know, I think that's partially why I kind of burn out and, you know, just wanted right before Fraggle Rock, you know, I basically said, Jim, you know what? I want to get back to my acting and writing. And I kind of walked.
Yeah. So what was, so you were like the, not the, maybe the first, were you the first Telly Monster? No.
No, the history on Telly Monster, Bob Payne was the very
That's right.
Telly Monster. And the name of the character, this is a really good example of where writing conception can sometimes be overblown and the puppeteers need to come in and temper the character. And I remember on 81st Street in that studio, I remember seeing one of the first segments of the original Telly Monster being shot with Bob Payne. And he had these swirly, crazy eyes. I don't know if you ever saw that, but his eyes would spin.
Kind of like Cookie Monster's eyes spin?
Well, no, they were literally like pinwheels.
And
the puppeteer could hit him and they'd literally spin. And he literally was conceived by the writers as a monster who would sit in front of television, a Telly Monster, and be transfixed by television. After two or three segments, the writers and the producers and the directors realized, this isn't a good idea. So he was, Ed Christie was the one who built him, I'm pretty sure. The crazy spin wheel eyes were taken off. He became a generic monster, just like Elmo started as a generic monster. And one day, the same season, later in the season, Carol Spinney was riding his bicycle to the studio on 57th Street at the time. He fell off his bike, sprained his ankle, and it was a classic. The understudy has to step in. John Stone, the director, reconceived the show, and Telly Monster took over for Big Bird because he couldn't perform.
Oh, wow.
He couldn't get into his costume with his swollen ankle and everything. And I came up with a voice, and that's how the origins of Telly Monster.
Telly Monster was the Sutton Foster of Sesame Street.
There you go.
So can you give us a taste, if you can muster it up, of your Telly Monster?
Well, I spent a lot of time talking to my children and my wife, you know, on vacation. And, you know, we'd drive by graveyards and I'd say, hey, how you doing? You know, so Telly Monster still lives in a little part of my heart and in my little immediate close family. Yes.
Oh, that's incredible. That's tremendous. I love it. I love that little sampling. So, I mean, you're like,
you're skipping on me.
What's that?
You were skipping on me there. I didn't hear what you said.
Oh, I love hearing your Telly Monster voice. It's fantastic. it's absolute treat.
He's a little more metro than Marty's. You know.
Yeah. Marty's is a little bit more tweaked up.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's
exactly.
And then you also the word on the street is that like you had your hands on the Elmo before he was Elmo.
Well, the interesting I consider myself the grandfather of Elmo because I think Jerry Nelson might have done him as a generic a couple times. And then I was handed Elmo and the writers had a conception of Elmo as they want him to be this, you know, kind of infant monosyllabic, kid who's obsessed, a monster who's obsessed with words, but he was bilingual. He would obsess with English words and Spanish words. And the only episode I kind of remember is it was kind of a verbal Cookie Monster and Elmo became obsessed with the word casa, and I spent the whole segment, not episode, segment, going in the Elmo voice was like the kind of person that a teenage girl might pick up and not want to hear. It was kind of like, And the word that Elmo was obsessed with was casa, casa, casa. So he was like kind of a junior version of Animal. With a word thing. And basically, you know, we did him for, I don't know, maybe 8 segments. And then I left. And then Richard Hunt took him for a while. And he had kind of a, you know, youthful kind of character. But he hated the puppet. He hated it. It wasn't a good fit. And he literally kind of threw the puppet at Kevin Clash and said, here, you do something with it.
That's incredible.
And that's how, so Elmo really had kind of 3.5 generations before Kevin got a hold of him and put him through the roof. So I like to say my claim to fame with Sesame Street is I did a lot to make Kevin and Elmo really famous by getting out of his way.
It's really incredible.
The keys to the casa. As
yes, I've gone to the casa.
It really is fascinating with all these puppets, from Kermit to Elmo and everything in between, as puppeteers, as it gets passed from one puppeteer to the next, how the personality really evolves significantly and really begins to take on that parts of the puppeteer's personality and stuff. And so it really is, it's incredible the history and the generations of a lot of the really famous the famous puppets out there and how they
this is my own bias is in my short term at Sesame Street compared to a lot of guys who've been there for a lot longer. But I think the most successful puppets were the puppets that were passed on to another puppeteer, and the puppeteer was allowed a wide range of changing the character, and they could make the character their own and make it better. And some of the characters that literally puppeteers were instructed to, no, you have to do it like so-and-so did it. You know, you can't completely, you know, it's like trying to do Olivier's Hamlet. You got to do your own Hamlet.
Yeah.
So, you know, I really appreciated and loved working with the producers and directors that understood that, you know, when you passed on a puppet to someone else, they had to put their own imprint on it.
True.
Some of the more...
There's always a fine line between, especially if it's a long-standing character that's been around for years and years and years, there's mm-hmm. always what they like to call character integrity. Like, so mm-hmm. the character exists, and it has existed for this long. So there's these certain bullet points that you do have to hit, but then when a new performer takes it over, you have to add your own flair, because you're never going to really be able to do a carbon copy of like somebody else's. Like, nobody will ever be able to do Jim's Kermit. Like, so, but
well, that I'm seeing is, yeah.
Kermit has, you know, very specific personality points that you have to hit, and then you go from there. But I think it's always important to let the performer take on, you know, put his own little spin on it.
Yeah.
And I see here that you originated Dr. Noble Price. Is that true? Were you the OG Dr. Price?
I think there was only one Dr. Nobel Price.
I think Kevin took it over after you left, just like Elmo.
So, Dr. Nobel Price. I'm thinking of the character on Eureka.
We'll get there, Brian. Don't worry.
Have its own little moment.
I know. Yeah, I was the original Dr. Nobel Price, and he was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed him.
Well, actually, just a beautiful character too. Such a fun character to like look with.
Yeah,
look at
him. One of the things I love doing with him is the tie he always wore was actually a tie I had collected when I lived in Maine back in the 70s, and that was his tie. And I still have a picture of him somewhere, a lovely picture of him. But Nobel Prize was a lot of fun with his invention.
It's a solid pun. It's hard to beat a good pun like that.
Yeah.
Nobel Prize.
it's phenomenal. But you also worked on Dog City, I see, Wubulous World. You had your hands in a few puppet projects here and there.
Yeah. Yeah, after I was doing some writing and I kind of came back and was trying to, you know, do some puppeteering and stuff, Dog City was one of the ones that I came back for. And I got to say, that was an example where I was told, you know, I had to do I can't even remember the name of the character.
Bruno.
Bruno, thank you. I was told.
We have your dossier here in front of us.
Yeah, I was told I had to do Jim's version of Bruno. And it was a voice that I had a very hard time doing. I could do the voice, but I couldn't be expressive in it. Mm-hmm. And I fought. I tried to change the voice. They wouldn't let me. And I got to say, it was not a character that was one of my favorites, because I felt like I was doing a retread of someone else's take on it. And the original kind of Dog City thing was very different from the series. But anyway, it was a fun show to work on, and there were some great young, you know, Lisa Buckley got her start on that show, and she was great to work with, and so it was a fun show.
Someone in the chat is asking about the time that you came back to Sesame and interacted with Marty's telly. Did something like that happen? Is there a fun story there?
I don't think I ever interacted as another character with Telly. There were kind of more big group scenes and Muppet segments that I was involved in. I love the idea that, you know, there was going to be a telly, two tellies in a cage match, yeah, kind of thing. But,
that
never happened. I mean, the great irony is Marty Robinson lives about, I don't know, a mile and a half from me in the same town in Connecticut. And her wife are friends, and we see each other quite often.
That's great. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So tell me about how you got roped into the one and only Nickelodeon's Eureka's Castle, because this is a show that like established.
How excited Dan is right now.
I was so tickled.
I could see the twinkle in his eyes.
Yeah. Both eyes are twinkling.
His cheeks are getting ready. He's almost ready to go into Telemonster eyes.
Yeah. It's funny because getting involved in the puppetry world, working as a puppeteer, and then starting to meet the people that I am now friends with, it's amazing to now be friends with, you know, with Magellan. It's amazing to be friends with Noel. You know, when like Noel was cleaning out his old place, now I have a box in my closet, and some of it's already on my it's sitting on my shelf on display of like all of the old Eureka's Castle toys that he had, and he's like, here's sending them to a good home.
Those rubber things that were plush toys,
those rubber puppets and stuff.
I know. Now I know, Dan, where to send my set. I'll send them to you.
Just put me in the will. Not that it's happening anytime soon, but just put me in the will. Eureka's Castle stuff. So tell us a story about how you joined up with that crew and how that got started.
Well, I basically had that was like maybe 90, 91, something like that. I'd kind of pulled out of Sesame Street. The only thing I'd done with Sesame Street is I went back to play Barkley in the special Big Bird in Japan in 86, I believe, or 87. But they approached me, wanted me to, you know, mainly Krupa, wanted me to do some characters, and I said, yeah, but I want to write. So basically it was a trade-off. I was happy to puppeteer and go down to Florida and work and do all into writing, and I had a great time writing with, you know, R.L. Stein as our first head writer and other head writers and stuff. And it was great fun. It was great fun. I really enjoyed the show, and Mr. Neck was so much fun to do. I still, you know, I grew up, and my kids grew up hearing, I'm an acorn small and round, laying on the cold, cold ground. When someone walks over me. How's it go, Dan?
I have the worst. I know the opening theme song, but that's it.
I get cracked or something. That I'm a nut, and then it goes, I'm a nut.
I remember the song, but I don't have it memorized. Yeah. So the minute you started singing it, something fired in the back of my brain. Okay.
But Mr. Knack was a lot of fun, and then working with Pam, with Bog and Quagmire was great too.
Oh, those puppets. Those puppets, I was in love with all the puppets on the show, but the little like warts on Bog and Quagmire always just disturbed me just a little bit. Not upset me or anything, but those balls, those like, you know, like those like warty bulbousy things always just got me a little upset.
Yeah.
But man, Mr. Knack was just great. I loved, and going back and watching a bunch of episodes, because I've done that recently, they're only like 14-minute episodes. I always remember that every character was in every episode, but it really wasn't the case. They really focused on like, here's Magellan and
Eureka and Magellan and Eureka. We're really the main two kind of go-to point of view things for the young kids.
What were some of your favorite episodes, some of your favorite bits? Because you were writing on it and you were performing in it. So what is some of the, tell us about writing for it. What are some of the episodes that you particularly enjoy writing, or what are some of the bits?
You're testing my memory. I don't remember any particular writing bits. I mean, they were constantly, I think, trying to get me to pull me back because I'd want to do crazy stuff. And they'd remind me that, no, there's a curriculum here, and I'd want to go off curriculum.
Was there a specific like syllabus / curriculum that they really were stringent about you guys following?
You know what? I believe the curriculum was really getting along and relationships. It was one of those early shows. It wasn't a math curriculum. It wasn't a reading curriculum. It was more about this very diverse group of characters and teaching kind of getting along with diversity and all that stuff. Because you had everything from, you know, dinosaurs to bats to blah, blah, blah. It was a very soft curriculum, and when it came to educational broadcasting, in 2000, when Bush came into office, those curriculums got very strict. You had to be teaching math, you had to be teaching reading, blah, blah, blah. So Eureka's Castle is kind of a throwback to an era where, you know, just the general good feelings and being friends on the playground was enough of a curriculum for educational television. Right. And granted, remember, this wasn't PBS, this was Nickelodeon, so they were a little looser too.
Sure. It was all basically, you know, just be nice to your fellow kids, and it's okay if they're weird and different than you.
Yeah, and they have, you know, major hairy warts all over them and stuff. But I think one of my favorite episodes, Dan, that I only remember it because I have an ancestor of German heritage back in the 1800s whose name was Thusnelda. And Thusnelda was part of the German pantheon. And, you know, my email name is Twisco, and I use Twisco Press as the name of my company right now. And her brother was named Tusco or Twisco. So it's this ancestral thing. But Mr. Knack had a whole episode about either his aunt or his grandmother. And I got to name the aunt, or Grandma Thusnelda. And I, to this day, I still have, you know, Matt, what's his name? I don't want to say Dottard. It's not an illustrator. He made this beautiful drawing, Thusnelda, which was like, you know, the classic drawing of Grandma, whatever her name is, the profile in the wheelchair. And I have this drawing of Granny Thusnelda, which was Mr. Knack's relatives. And that was one episode I loved writing because it was all about Granny Thusnelda.
That's phenomenal. That's really great. So you said it was Jim that roped you into it. I imagine you interact with them through all the Sesame and Muppet stuff. How'd you get hooked up with, how'd you become buddies with Jim? Well, that he was influential enough to pull you back into the world.
Jim was very much around on Sesame Street, another background puppeteer for the Muppet segments and all that. So I knew him from that. You know, he was working in Kermit's shop, so I knew him as a builder way back when. And we had done a couple of other projects. Kevin Clash did a pilot on doing puppets to the Peanuts characters. And I played Charlie Brown on that. And I believe Jim also played a character on that. And there was another show that Kevin did before he came to Sesame Street that Jim and I worked on a little bit. I forgot the name of Kevin's show that was pretty successful before he came into Sesame Street. Because when I left Sesame Street, that's when kind of Kevin came in. So Jim and I had run into each other a lot and worked together. We hit it off.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah.
The Great Space Coaster. Are you thinking about the Great Space
Coaster? Yes. Yes. Thank you, Nate. That was it. That was it.
Oh yeah. Our friends on Twitter that we like to get into pun wars with sometimes, the Great Space Coaster.
We do puppet pun wars with the Great Space Coaster on
Twitter. So Noel asked me to ask you about Mr. Nack's accent and the origins of that. Okay. He said something about Richard Hunt doing it one way and giving you a hard time or something like that. Is there a decent story about Mr. Nack's weird accent?
I love Noel's creative memory going on. I don't unless it's me just getting too old. I don't remember Richard Hunt being involved in any way with Eureka's Castle. Basically,
Nate, read that wrong? He said,
I think that's what he said.
Yeah, he said Richard Hunt did it was an East Indian accent. So maybe he.
Wait a minute. There may have Richard Hunt, and this would be the first time I'm hearing about this. So basically, what you're telling me is that Jim Krupa's second pick for Mr. Nack was me.
I don't know.
I was a very, very good friend of Richard Hunt. I never heard until this moment that Richard Hunt had auditioned for Mr. Nack. So this explains, this contextualizes the conversation I had with Hugh Martin, the director, who's had a huge responsibility for that show being successful. He directed all of it. He was brilliant. He was so good. And we loved working with him. But when I started doing Mr. Nack, Hugh basically told me, could you think of kind of a foreign accent that he would be, but it can't be identifiable to any country. And he said, and I forget if I said this, I think he said it. He said, think of Mr. Nack as from a country called Ethnia. And that's where I just started playing vocally and just came up with this generic, you know, I don't know where I'm from, you know?
Yeah, because I remember he had such an interesting way of speaking and was...
Yes, Mr. Nack was from Ethnia, you know? You tell me where I'm from.
Yeah, we just so we broke a big story here, telling you about Richard Hunt. So I don't know if Noel knows that or not. So,
but yeah, Noel's always been a troublemaker. So,
yeah. I just, man, that show just tickles me so much. It just fills my heart with joy. It's pretty incredible that you were you started off as just a regular old body. Puppeteer, like a full body actor, and then wiggled your way into wiggling dollies and doing fun voices. That's phenomenal.
We're talking about Moomin Chance, and I'm trying to, if any of our listeners or watchers, maybe to visually conceptualize that, if they're familiar with the Muppet Show, the Moomin Chance did an episode of the Muppet Show.
It's my favorite episode of the Muppet Show, bar none.
They have that super famous little bit with the clay
faces. Yes, clay faces.
Constantly yes. Changing. All different emotions, just really turn into a whole different face and smush it back in together. It was such a cool.
Yeah, it was the closing number of the show, and the two guys did it, and it was a fantastic piece to close the show with. It was so much fun, weird stuff would happen, like your contact at the end when they smash together would be so solid that when you try to pull apart. Have to put it back on. I saw Moomin Chance maybe 6-7 years ago when they were down and performing at a theater in NYU, and they still do that number. They still do it. It's one of their classics. It's a great piece.
Yeah, it's like why mess with what works?
Yep.
Don't mess with excellence. So you also wrote on a bunch of awesome kid shows.
I would love to talk more about your writing career.
Yeah, because it says here in my dossier that you worked on Codename Kids Next Door, which was such a phenomenal children's show.
Right, with and then Mo Willems went on to, you know, fame and fortune with his books. Mo Willems worked on that. He was one of the head writers. He and Joey Mazzarino were very instrumental in that. And just to give you another footnote, Joey Mazzarino got his start on Eureka's Castle. I don't know if you remember the episode with one of the musicians. He's no longer with us. not Pendergast. You know, it's there was a wonderful special we did with a musician, and Joey came in. It was like a Halloween special of Eureka's Castle. And Joey was in on that and played the scary, scary monster in that show. And he was just this eager beaver kid. And that was his beginnings.
Oh, really? That's awesome. Yeah. We still have to get Joey on the show and talk to him about all of his all his wonderful puppetry stuff.
I'm looking at Eureka's Castle on IMDb, and IMDb is sorely lacking with Eureka's Castle information.
Oh, really? Oh.
Yeah, there's no episode list. It says that everybody was only in it for one episode, like Noel McNeil of Magellan, one episode. Krupa, one episode.
We'll get Noel on that. You know, he's got to fix that.
Cheryl Blaylock, like one episode. And it's weird. So there's no, you know, typically on IMDb, there's an episode list and you can see the little captions or details of what the episode was about, but there is no episode description.
Whose fault is that? Maybe Nickelodeon's, you know, dropping the ball there. Or they want to disown
a lot of Nickelodeon's.
Go ahead.
I know a lot of Nickelodeon's classic shows are really lacking with a lot of information on YouTube, just as on the internet as a whole. There's just it's a bummer. But I mean, at the same time, if you think about it, they were just churning out shows like it was their job. Yeah, so, you know, they were pushing out shows.
Video or I know that a lot.
Yeah, there's VHSs of them out there, and there's. DVD? Not that I'm aware of. And there are lots of really terrible rips of them on YouTube. You can find VHS, most of them.
Bootlegs on the YouTube.
Yeah, a lot of them were so... so, like, the audio is... Like, it's always got that, like, low-end hiss in the background. You know what I mean?
And the damn tracking. Fixing the tracking.
Yeah, fixing the tracking.
I'll have to look into my VHS tapes because, you know, for my writer's reel, I used to save episodes. And I'll look into my tapes and see if I've got anything on any of those episodes.
You could get millions of hits on YouTube.
Oh, okay. Just what I'm waiting for.
Yeah. and then also says you worked on the Magic School Bus. Get out of here, Brian.
I did. I spent many a season on that show.
That's really?
Awesome. Oh, probably wrote dozens of episodes.
How do you feel about the theory that she was a Time Lord? Because
that Miss Frizzle was a Time Lord?
I didn't know that was a theory. I know that Mary Poppins being a Time Lord.
Wait. You got to back me up here. I'm out of the loop. Well, you got to define a Time Lord for me.
Well, Doctor Who is a Time Lord. Doctor Who, if you're not familiar, he has a big blue box. He has his TARDIS that has the ability to change into anything, can shift into anything, and he's timeless.
Space and time.
He's timeless, and he lives forever, and he's just a little eccentric, a little crazy, has always got some clever gadgets, and it's just... it just like the parallels that could be drawn between Miss Frizzle and the Magic School Bus and Doctor Who and his TARDIS is just kind of.
Well, I have some inside information that furthers the theory that Miss Frizzle is a Time Lord. They are doing new episodes of Magic School Bus.
I did hear about that.
Yeah, I've heard through the grapevine.
Jocelyn Stevenson, one of the co-head writers with George Bloom, they're working on new episodes from based over in London, but they'll probably be animated and done here, which is amazing. So since they're, I don't know how many episodes were finally done, like almost 100.
Mrs. Frizzle was played by Lily Tomlin, correct, originally?
Yeah, yeah.
I think the rumor is that it's Kate McKinnon. Is that right?
Okay. You know more than me.
Was there a special Magic School Bus episode that you remember writing or that you were fond of?
You know, there were some that were really difficult to do given the science that we had to, the episode on light was very difficult. The episode on flying was difficult, you know, aerodynamics and stuff. But they always presented, you know, their unique challenge. I think my favorite episode, and you got to realize that sometimes as the team of writers, particularly in the first three or four seasons, as the team of writers would work on these, Jocelyn or Stevenson or George, the co-head writers, sometimes they would take away a draft and give it to another writer because they knew their stable of writers, and they'd realize, okay, they you need a Brian touch on this, or you need a, you know, whatever his name was, May, from the Canadian guy. So there was a lot of handprints on a lot of those episodes. But I think my favorite episode in Magic School Bus was when they went through Ralphie's digestive tract.
Yes.
I feel like that is one of the good episodes for those people.
And they had to decide when they finally got through the last of the small intestine, they had to decide whether to go out of Ralphie's exterior end or backtrack. And it was one of the great kind of theatrical dilemmas.
Quite the
dilemma. And they did reverse, and they went out another way.
That's great.
That was a great episode.
Do you have any great Carlos jokes that you remember? Because that's always my favorite bit, when Carlos says something ridiculous and everyone's like, Carlos.
If they wanted wordplay and bad puns, they usually handed the script to me.
Great. That warms my heart to know that.
Yeah, yeah. And one of the reasons that I started writing books was, you know, starting with Magic School Bus, you know, these scripts were only supposed to be 35 pages at most. And my first drafts would sometimes be 55 pages because I wanted everything in there. And then George and Jocelyn would beat me up. And at that point, I always realized that, yeah, I write long. Maybe I should go to prose, straight prose. one of the stories about Magic School Bus, because one of the things that drove me into writing books was the censorship in children's television, particularly PBS-style television. And one of the episodes that drove me crazy and inspired one of my novels, Suck It Up, was I was writing a show about chemistry. And the whole big aha of the chemistry show was everything breaks down into smaller parts. Everything's made of parts. That was the big aha we wanted to share with first to third graders who watched the show. And I had a wedding cake, you know, because you had to write the description. It's animation. You got to write everything. I had a wedding cake with all the different parts that would be on a wedding cake, the bride and the groom, you know, little horns, little angels and all that stuff. And I was told by the producers, Brian, you need to cut the angels. And I went, why? Well, they're religious, but most religions, except for Confucians, have angels. And it's like, no, you got to cut the angels. And I was like, yeah, drove me crazy.
Yeah. I hear that's only gotten worse. So you got out the right time.
Yeah.
Could you talk real quick about Between the Lions? Because I know you also worked on that too, right?
It was a great, fun show to work on. I kind of weaseled in there via Sarah Durkee, who was a big a lyrics writer, songwriter for Sesame Street and Between the Lions. And it was a great, fun show. I mean, I did a little puppeteering in the background as well, stuff when they needed extra puppeteers. But that was such a working with Norm. That's wonderful. So I knew him from Sesame Street pretty well, and working for him on that show, it was so wacky, and it had a lot of Norman's kind of Sesame Street unplugged flavor to it. It was a lot of fun to write for, and there was a lot of liberties to it because it was a kind of magazine format, very different segments and all of that. So it was fun.
It's awesome. Before we talk about some of your books, because I'm interested in how you translate, how you went from loud mime to Barkley to puppeteer to writer to writing children's episodes and then onto writing books. But it says on my little dossier that you were credited in Muppets Take Manhattan and the Great Muppet Caper. Did you work on the films, like as you were bouncing around? Because were they
Great Muppet Caper? We were doing pre-production on Dark Crystal. And whenever they needed background puppeteers for big scenes, they pulled us off this. They pulled us literally across the street from the EMI studio or in Elstree. And they pulled us across the street to the Muppet place and we would do stuff. So I did very little on that one. But when we came to shooting Muppets Take Manhattan out at, I forget the studio in Long Island City or Queens where we shot it. Oh, it was Astoria. We shot it in Astoria, I believe. Anyway.
Was it Astoria Kaufman or like Silver Cup?
No, actually Silver Cup. Bingo. It was Silver Cup. I had a character on that, Ratatouille, which is one of the rats in the kitchen. And
the tattooed rat.
Yeah, the Ratatouille. And so I was the one. The thing I remember, the biggest thing was catching the toast. I remember trying to catch the toast that came out of the toaster. We did so many takes. And Jim said, we got to give this up. And I said, Jim, just one more take. And bingo, I caught the toast. But the other one I remember is Ratatouille pops out of a coffee maker. Mm-hmm. And I remember being in that thing, and they had it sealed, my arms up literally in the liquid, it's sealed, and Ratatouille's got a pop-up, and all my clothes were covered in instant coffee, which is a god-awful smell. And I remember riding the subway back to the city, people looking at me like, what the hell?
So wait, they were using real coffee in the coffee maker?
You know, I stunk up the car with my instant coffee clothing.
That's awesome. That's really great. The rats in the Muppet movies just always take
that
the cake for me.
That scene is so strong. The whole kitchen scene. The whole
kitchen, with Rizzo leading Rizzo and all his rat buddies, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I mean, we didn't really touch on it, but I mean, I imagine you spent some time with Jim. Do you have any fun Jim stories? In any of the times you've interacted with him or spent time with him?
No, I guess I remember Jim as, you know, particularly in the pre-production of Dark Crystal, we'd have these meetings in the shops where the guys, all the body puppeteers are working on. We'd have these meetings around these tables, you know, dealing with the Skeksis head and how the carving's going and all that stuff. And I just remember it was the closest I got to working with Jim in a kind of pre-production kind of mode because he wanted to hear opinions from the puppeteers and the builders and the designers. And I just remember him always being like, oh, good. Oh, yeah, that's good. And he would just be this sponge. And he would just soak up, and a lot of people have said this, he'd just soak up what the people he surrounded him with were contributing. And he was such a master of taking that information and synthesizing it into his own vision. I mean, a couple stories from Dark Crystal where I just saw Jim in complete kid heaven. Was one, you know, the scene when the plants are stuck in the ground and they fly out, you know, these plants fly mm-hmm. out and stuff. We were all up on cranes and in cherry pickers dropping these spiked things into styrofoam sets, and we're up there dropping them and everything, and then the film was reversed, so they popped out, and Jim's up there just like a little kid dropping these things. And the other time that he was so much fun was in the hallways during the Skeksis scenes in the Skeksis castle. In the hallways when they were running around, you'd see these little bugs running through the hallways, these things. And we were all, Jim included, hidden behind these little portals and entranceways, and we'd wind up these toys with hairy legs and just throw them like little hairy grenades into the thing. And Jim was like a 5-year-old. He was just loving it. So that's what was so, you know, that's kind of my memory of working with him, is that he was just a little kid on the set. He loved it so much, and he never lost that, despite the fact that, you know, he's got these major responsibilities and directing and, you know, pressures from the suits and all of that kind of stuff.
Yeah. So the business didn't take that out of him.
He was able to compartmentalize extremely well.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. Yeah. So you went from silly mime to a dog.
Loud mime.
No,
loud
you went from a loud mime to
thank you, Nate.
to a quiet Swedish Mummin to a dog to working on children's television to writing for children's television, and then you kind of went on to start writing your own novels. And so what tell us about your novels, because it got
the pivot, you know you could sum it up with a very checkered past, but the pivot was after 9/11, and the Bush administration came in. The corporate money dried up for educational television, and the Department of Education money dried up, and there was very little production of educational style television in New York City. So I was out of a job, and that's where I kind of went, well, I've always written long. Why not write a novel? So I ended up writing, you know, my first novel called Out of Patience, and it ended up, you know, getting me an agent and getting sold and getting published. And I loved it so much because there was, particularly in novel writing, depending on what publisher you're with, there's much less censorship than in television because there's less money involved. And I always encourage writers, because I spent quite a few years writing screenplays, spec screenplays, and had a few optioned, but never one bought by a studio and made. And I always encouraged writers for the last 15 years who want to write screenplays. The spec screenplay market's very difficult. If you get some hit on Blacklist, great. You may break out. But it's much less money and much less risk for publishers to publish a novel. And so I encourage young writers to, you know, if you've got a great screenplay, write the screenplay, but then novelize it and try to sell the novel too. Because you can make more money selling the movie rights to a novel. And it's easier to do, it's a little easier to do than actually selling a spec screenplay.
It's some of the best advice for writers that I probably have ever heard, because there are a lot of people out there, you know, desperately trying to make it big in writing movies and stuff like that. And it's like,
I'll give you a wonderful example. There's a friend of mine, his name's Bill Fitzhugh. He wrote probably 8-10 spec screenplays. He was living in Seattle, eventually moved to LA, wrote these wonderful screenplays, never sold a one. This is starting in the 80s. He then novelized just about all his screenplays, and he sold every one of them as a novel, and then sold the movie rights to the novel of the screenplay that he has in the trunk.
That's incredible. That's a great.
Yeah.
So that's like a A+ life hack there for writers. If you're trying to make it big, just stop and write your book, and then let it take off, because it's really the way you're going to get in front of as many eyes as possible. Yeah. So that's such a wonderful thing. And so you dabble in the vampires, right? The teenage vampire stories.
Well, my censorship story about television, the other little story that drove me crazy was I was on a different show, a math curriculum show. And we were told by the producers, and this was Sesame Workshop or something, we were told by the producers, you know, it's first to third grade math. You can't write any episodes about birthday parties. And I went, what? Why can't we birthday cakes, numbers, it's a natural. Why can't we write about birthday parties? We don't want to offend any Jehovah's Witnesses who don't celebrate birthdays or the celebration of self. And this kind of cued my second novel. And I went, how far are we going to go with this kind of censorship? And it popped a question into my head, given all the multiculturalism and all the stuff going on. I went, what's America? It's yet to be recognized. My answer is simple. Vampires. Needs, special diets, all that stuff. So my whole novel, Suck It Up, is a very satiric kind of comedic version of vampires and, you know, undead Americans, they're called at one point.
They're not sparkly, are they?
No, they're not sparkly. Yeah. But I got to ride the coattails of, you know, Twilight and all of that. And, you know, my character staking is a hate crime in my vampire world.
That was just really interesting how you just, I never even thought of it that way, to attribute vampires with special needs. They have very specific.
Yeah. Well, this my lead character, he's a completely accidental wimpy vampire. You know, I should have named it the Wimpy Vampire series. You know, he can't stand blood. He can't stand the sight of it. He drinks a soy blood substitute called Blood Light. You know, so the jokes and the puns just roll.
The puns, man. Coming out with them.
Or flow, as we might want to say in vampire lore.
Truth.
Yeah, yeah.
That's awesome. So do you long to get back into writing scripts for kids shows, for kids TV, or for any television? Yeah, is it something
got,
that...
You got anything rolling around in the brain of yours that you can talk about?
You know what, guys? To be honest, I've had many other opportunities to work for kids television, and I writing novels, I don't look back. Writing novels is so much more fun, so much more control for me. You know, I don't have to deal with compromise and you know, certainly I have to deal with an editor when I'm writing and all of that, but I'd rather deal with something that's much more complex and stand alone than a series. And I've always wanted to write older. And there were shows that I worked on that, you know, preschool shows, where I literally had to start my writing day by putting my head on the desk for about 5 minutes and shutting down three quarters of my brain. So you know, writing for really young, like Out of the Box was a show that was fun to write for, but it was so...
Out of the Box! Out of the Box!
Yeah. Oh, I feel bad for you, Dan. But you know...
How can you not remember that theme song, though?
I mean, of course I do. But writing for teenagers and writing young adult, and my latest piece is more for even for millennials, because millennials are still reading young adult because of the Harry Potter series and Hunger Games and Twilight. There's a new category in town called new adult, and new adult goes from 16 to 29. YA is a very healthy kind of a part of the market, and I do like writing for older kids. You can be more edgy. You can do more edgy humor. You can get away with stuff that you can't get away with writing for, you know, sub 8-year-olds.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, it's clear as day that this was how a lot of puppeteers and a lot of how the people in our community are. I mean, you look at stuff like Puppet Up now. Is that what it's called? No Strings Attached. What is it called now, Nate?
It's back to Puppet Up.
Is it back to Puppet Up? So you got this like incredibly adult, you know, just mature themes.
Mature themes.
Henson alternative.
I love it.
Yeah, and so we know that while you were there making Sesame Street and these Muppet movies and Dark Crystal, that when the cameras were off, these puppets were doing all kinds of silly non acceptable things. You know, it has to, there has to be a release for people in this industry, because constantly catering to the 4-year-olds, you can only do it for so long before your head wants to pop.
You begin to go crazy. Yeah, Dan, you'd appreciate that. This being you, being the Eureka's Castle nutcase aficionado that you are, but we had a code on the set, and Noel would remember this, because the puppets would get rather vile and do all sorts of strange things when the cameras weren't rolling. And if there were kids on the set, because the Nickelodeon studios,
because the walking
tours, but it was glassed in. They either maybe were piped in sound and they could hear us sometimes. But if there were actually kids that came onto the actual set, there was a code among the puppeteers, and you'd say the sky is blue, which meant you had to clean up your act.
They still use that code on Sesame Street to this day.
Okay, good. Yeah.
Yeah.
They, blue sky. I remember. The sky is blue, yeah.
Yeah.
I remember Noel telling us a few great stories about the fact that kids walking in to some inappropriate stuff going on. So that's great. Yeah.
We've talked about it a few times. It's like almost every children's program, I guess it's most over the top fictionalized with the movie Death of Smoochie, or Death by Smoochie.
Death to Smoochie
with Robin Williams and Ed Norton, is that like you work on these children's programs and you have to be so clean and so good and all that time, that that's your release valve. When it turns off, everything gets, it can be the bluest the bluest set you can one can be on as a children's program.
Yeah, it builds up these toxins, these immature toxins that must be released. It's kind of like a spit valve on a trumpet.
Exactly. It's exactly what it is. Get a lid off that steam.
Yeah. So if people want to see your books and whatnot, we talked about this before we started recording, because I don't know how to spell your name because it's spelled 12 different ways depending on where you look.
Two different ways at least.
Well, there were umlauts, Nate, that you weren't there for. Yeah, we were talking about umlauts.
Damn it! I actually had an umlaut conversation.
Actually, just to really confuse you, Nate, for one season on Sesame Street, I was Brian Wolf.
Why would that happen?
Because I was sick of the name, I was sick of the confusion, and I had a German couple in the German theater in New York in my family back in the late 1800s, and their name was Wolf. And when I got tired of all the name problems, the first thing I did before I got married is I changed it. But I was in a musical with Estelle Parsons that was the most god-awful experience I've ever went through, called Queen Elizabeth. And I said, this is a bad omen, and I changed it. But I think for the whole season, the credit roll was Wolf. It was probably 82 or 83.
Right.
So just to confuse you further, you need to, there are several dossiers on me.
But if people want to check out your awesome books and learn more about you, where do they go? Where should we go?
I have two websites, and the one that's kind of representing all the books I've done in the last 10 years is brianmeehl.com, and it's M-E-E-H-L, brianmeehl.com. And then my new website, because my new book, and it's the first book in a trilogy, it's called the Blowback Trilogy, and I have a website dedicated to that trilogy that's called blowbacktrilogy.com.
Awesome.
And you also have a Facebook page and a Twitter.
Yep.
Blowback. Brian, you're on Twitter?
I am, but you know, I don't believe it. I'm really kind of not, Dan, because I'm not figuring it out. And it's just completely like it's like digital vomit to me. I just don't get it. I'm managing kind of on Facebook, but yeah. It's for someone my age. It's overwhelming. I'm trying to do, you know. Yeah. But
it is when you're on Twitter and you have enough people that you're following. It is a digital vomit. It's a great way to like describe it because you can just imagine this big open mouth at the top of the Twitter feed, and there's just tweets constantly pouring out of it. Yep. So because
when I'm thinking about doing another, because I have a blog on my website that relates to the first book, Blowback 07. And I did it all fall, and I'm kind of, you know, stopped right now on social media kind of stuff. I do occasional stuff. But, you know, people tell me that, you know, and particularly my daughters, younger people, said, Twitter's over. Go to Instagram. And I do like the look of Instagram better. It's simpler. It's cleaner. It's sanitized vomit.
It's pretty vomit. It's pretty filtered vomit.
It's pretty vomit.
It's filtered vomit. It's vintage filtered and chrome and all.
I wouldn't necessarily say that Twitter's dead, but
I agree.
It's all over the place, but yeah, that's great. So what's your Twitter and your Facebook? It's just Brian Meehl on Facebook.
My Twitter is Blowback Bri.
At Blowback in the
first,
Bri.
Yeah, and the Facebook. You know, I have my personal Facebook page, which is just Brian Meehl. But then I have an author Facebook page, which is Brian Meehl Author. And that's where, you know, I prefer to, you know, kind of interact with people.
You ever post any throwback nuggets of your puppetry days on those?
You know what I've actually thought about with the coming, is it DC or Marvel who's doing the Dark Crystal comic book sequel?
Oh, I don't know. I think it's DC.
It's coming out in the fall. And yeah. I've actually been thinking about doing a little Dark Crystal stories and sharing some of the visuals, you know, like this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And
I've been thinking about doing that too. Taking nice little shots of all the good
Absolutely.
Stuff that you have. Even just like the label of the Dark Crystal on your script on Instagram would make people go nuts.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So
we'll put it on eBay and see what I can get.
Too.
Oh, you can probably get a pretty penny. Yeah, I We'll make sure that our page is following you. And when you post, when you start getting into posting that kind of fun stuff, we'll start sharing it for you and getting it, getting out to, right, the puppet fans and all those puppet folks.
I've got a ton of puppet people I've connected with Facebook, and it is amazing. I you know, friended all these puppet people that I kind of don't know. So my whole Facebook presence has been invaded by puppets and puppeteers.
See, Brian, there you are. There you go again, messing with the social media.
I got to say that.
It's stranger danger.
I got to tip my hat to, you know, the puppeteers. They're like, you know, viral out there.
They found you. It's puppeteers, digital puppeteers, stranger danger, Brian. You got to be careful.
I don't know how, but they found me. Run for it, Brian. Yes.
I'll make sure to send you a friend request and you can see all my weird. No, we don't do a lot of, I don't post a lot of weird puppet stuff because I much like you, had to run away from the business in order to pay my bills and, you know, live successfully.
Right, so,
right. Money pouring out of puppets these days.
I know. But you, unfortunately, you can never get Eureka's Castle out of your system.
No. It's my mother's like favorite embarrassing story to tell about me. If anyone knows what Eureka's Castle is, her go-to is talking about how I would just intentionally smash my face. Mm-hmm. Yep. I would just intentionally smash into everything and say, I meant to do that.
Yeah. That's the beard covering up all the scars.
All the scars hidden underneath the beard.
So much scar tissue.
Yeah.
Well, it's been an absolute pleasure speaking with you, sir. It's great. I love some of the enlightening stories. I love going into, like, I know well enough, and so does Nate. We know well enough about puppetry, but you know, we know about the puppeteers and some of the stories. But it's just so great to hear the origins of things like Telling Monster and Elmo and stuff like that. It's great hearing it firsthand from the guy who.
Well, I gotta say it's amazing that, you know, there's a whole younger generation that is so interested in the history of all this stuff.
And I don't know if we're that young.
Yeah. Well, you're younger than me, so that makes you young. But you guys are aware of, you know, Frank Gaz made a documentary that I believe was in Sundance
this past
season.
Yeah, it's gonna play. It's playing at South by Southwest pretty soon. Muppet Guys Talking, I think, is the title of it.
Mm-hmm. Which sounds fascinating.
And yeah, it's him, Matt Vogel, Jerry Nelson. So
they got some of Jerry before he passed away.
I think the main round table discussion, or, you know, just them sitting around on couches is that. So that shows you how long ago they shot it, is before Jerry passed.
Oh, okay.
And so Jerry's on there, I think. Dave
Goals, yeah,
and
Joey Mazzarino.
I'm not sure. I remember they released, I saw a picture, like a still that was released not too long ago, and it was Frank, Jerry, I think Matt Vogel, Dave Gold,
Steve Whitmire.
I don't know if Steve was on there or not.
Frank's very selective.
Yeah, we always joke about getting him on the podcast. It's that one person that'll just never be on the podcast. But you know, well, as long as he's alive, we'll keep up the hope. So,
well, you know, he's one of the few people. Because, you know, the cliche I had in my mind as a puppeteer before I was a puppeteer was someone who was, everything came through their puppet, and they were just these, like, you know, shrinking violets under the puppet and stuff. And, there's some puppeteers that just want to, you know, be out front and stuff, and there's other puppeteers that just live by their foam.
Yep. That's great.
Foam and fleece.
Yes.
Well, it was an absolute pleasure having you, sir. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us and
share
your wonderful story and histories. It was a pleasure. Nate, you want to take us out?
I do. Before we go, I wanted to ask another Magic School Bus question.
Oh, boy. Here we go.
You know, the rumor about the Time Lord, but there's also apparently the rumor that the Magic School Bus kids then became the Planeteers from Captain Planet. I don't know if you can see that.
You're right. But you're right.
That kind of took the internet by storm not too long ago. And it was like, how did I never see this? There they are. They grew up to be the Planeteers.
This is a harbinger of the Dark Crystal sequel. You know, what will Jen and Kira grow up to be?
God. Will Jen ever get wings? Of course not. He's a boy.
Oh my gosh.
That's wonderful.
All right.
But, Brian, what we typically do, actually, before we go, since we were talking about petrifying puppets, do you yourself have like a petrifying puppet moment for like when you were a kid? Or is there still a puppet that maybe unsettles you upon sight? Or even,
okay. That's what you mean. I'm thinking, you know, rock wood, a petrified puppet can be hard to lip sync. No, I can't think of one. The only association I can think of was my childhood hero when I was 5 years old was Zorro. So I did begin behind a mask. You know, that was my hero with a sword with a little chalk thing on the end, and I'd Z people's clothing with chalk and stuff. And so I was Zorro when I was 5, 6 years old. So maybe that led to Moomin-Shanz, and, you know, that was my beginning of hiding behind a costume, which basically that's a definition of puppetry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's okay. You don't have to have a scary one. Not everyone does.
Well, you yourself
played some people's petrifying puppet. I mean, you are responsible for scaring the pants off of kids.
Now that I've had a little bit of time to you know, kind of yammer on about it, Nate, I did have a petrifying puppet moment, but it was so petrifying I can't remember it.
That's a good answer. We'll take that.
PTSD.
Puppet PTSD. PPTSD. Exactly.
Oh, Brian, typically how we end the show, when we sign off, Dan will say his name, I'll say my name, and then we'll toss it over to you. You say your name, and then if you would say our sign off phrase up to this point is, and we'll feel you up next time.
Okay, perfect.
You know, we're all about puns here, getting felt up, a puppetry podcast.
I love it.
And we'll fill you up next time. So we're going to throw that to you, and then you say, and we'll fill you up next time in a style of your choosing.
All right.
Use whatever voice or whatever, however you want to do it.
Any character of yours that you would like to do, that would be tremendous. But thank you again so much for joining us today. This was really great and wonderful. And
we'll
have
a lot of fun.
You on soon.
Thank you.
Talk more books. Do you have
what we need to do is we'll pair you up. We'll like bring Noel on and have you on, and we'll have a little
if we can get Jim on too. If we can get Jim Krupa on, we can do a whole little roundtable discussion. That would be fun. Because I know Pam, we still want to get Pam on too. She's been wanting to come back on as well.
Excellent.
We will definitely.
We're collecting. We're like halfway through the Eureka's Castle set.
Yeah,
so I'm glad to add you. Glad to add your little picture onto the ledge.
Excellent.
He doesn't have like a weird, creepy stalker map behind the camera right now or anything.
Yeah, I don't have any. Yeah, yeah.
Drawn across.
I mean, I have like a shelf, but it's not like a shrine or anything like that.
I'm just really glad Dan doesn't go to the wide shot.
Yeah.
You know what? Because he's not wearing pants.
No.
And neither am I, for that matter. But that's neither here nor there. So this has been Getting Felt Up, a puppetry podcast with Dan and Nate.
I'm Dan.
I'm Nate.
And I'm Brian, also known as Kelly, who would like to say, we'll feel you up later.
Yes.
That was perfect. That was
wonderful.
Awesome.
Fantastic.
Thank you so much.
That warmed my heart. Awesome.
Or how would Mr. Knack say, and we'll fill you up next time?
He would say, oh, we'll fill you up later. I don't know. Mr. Knack eludes me a little bit.
Yeah. It's been a while, so.
Yeah.
It's been like a solid 30 years since Mr. Knack has
yeah, you're right.
Been out there. I know, because, you know, I'm 30 years old, so I'm the same age as your marriage. So,
oh man, you got some dossier work going. Good.
Yeah. Well, you said you got married in 87, so that's.
He did the math.
See?
Yeah, that's when I was born. So, you know.
Right.
It's actually funny. I was telling Noel not too long ago. I went at Universal Studios here in Orlando, Florida. That they do the Halloween Horror Nights, and then they set up you know, a lot of the really detailed movie themed setups of horror movies in the old in the sound stages, and walking through, waiting in line for I believe it was the From Dusk Till Dawn haunted house So it was all themed like From Dusk Till Dawn with the vampire strippers and all that stuff at Universal.
Right.
But it was in the same set stage. As you're waiting in line, there was a plaque, just a wall of golden plaques of everything that was ever shot in that sound stage. And just waiting in line, I just happened to look, and I literally turned. I took a picture of it, and I texted it to Noel. There was Eureka's Castle shot on this in this soundstage. I was like, "Whoa! I'm about to go see some vampire strippers in your old soundstage."
Yeah, the sky is no longer blue, and that's
no, it is flowing red with blood. But hey, then you wrote vampire books, so it all comes back.
Yeah, there you go, yeah,
full circle. Awesome. Well, thank you so much, sir. We really appreciate
all right, guys.
It.
Thank
Thanks
you,
a lot.
Have a great night. Talk
soon. Have a wonderful evening.
You too.
I ejected him.
We're still going live.